For SBJ Spotlight, I'm Chris Smith, joined by Monumental Sports and Entertainment founder and chairman Ted Leontis. Ted, thank you for joining us and for welcoming us down to Washington, D.C. this week.
Thank you for coming.
So you just wrapped up a terrific conversation with your son, Zach, talking all things sports business. Wanted to follow up on a few specific areas. So one thing that Zach asked you about was sports as an emerging asset class. Something that's been interesting to me is how recently sports are really recognized as an asset class. That, you know, I think you talked about how for a long time it was almost a way to leverage, you know, to generate cash flow for real estate investors. For a long time, team ownership was almost an ego play. I can still count on my fingers the number of sports-specific investment firms in the VC world. Why do you think it has taken so long for investors and for the world at large to recognize sports as its own asset class and as one that has value and not just something to, you know, in addition to what else you're doing?
Well, I think people have misunderstood the business. Is it a real estate business? Is it a team business? Well, sports, that's about ego. You can't count on it. Now you're seeing a whole new generation of owner come in. They've primarily been tech people, private equity people. They understand what the burgeoning and great industries are. And they all go through this process of discovery like I did, right? I came from America Online. We just bought Time Warner. I said, I understand media. I understand bricks and clicks. And this looks like the best of those businesses because of the durability of the brand. Most Fortune 500 companies go look, AOL. We didn't exist 20 years later after we went public. Facebook just changed its name and brand to Meta. My thought this morning was, shouldn't you have changed the name Meta after you laid off the 13% of your workforce? There's turnover in the business world. It's not in sports. We're durable. And that durability made us, I think, undervalued. I've said this many times to Adam, which was people at a conference that Adam and I both spoke at. They said, congratulations, you're running a $80 billion industry company. If you take all 30 teams and you take their valuations, like $80 billion. I go, Adam, that's terrible. Okay, that means it's less than 8x revenues, because we're doing $11 billion, and there's zero value that's being ascribed to us for the logo, for the know-how, for the NBA name. It's all valued on how many teams, what's their revenues. And so as a lot of new people have come into ownership, mm-hmm. you wake up and you say, there's value to unlock here. And all we have to do is what's organic and natural to us. What is our business model? It is authentically selling a naming rights deal for 20 years. It's getting a TV contract, a digital partnership for 10, 20 years. It's our most transaction business, selling season tickets annually. You can just look. Every team is at 80% or 95% over 20 years. It's a predictable business. And that's why the values went up. And the only way you can now get your limited partners, partners pass away, partners want to cash out, they want liquidity. These numbers are huge, right. So private equity has come in. They had to do that, right? It's essentially a way for teams and leagues to get liquidity into the system. Well, once private equity comes in and you have private equity people buying teams and people who have taken companies public buying teams, you're going to have some kind of asset class formally created. Here's what to look for us. We need investor relations. We were joking about Forbes, Sportico. We have to take your enterprise, your organization, much more seriously. You're like the Wall Street Journal now of our business, right? And And I think you'll see that. I think across the board, the leagues are upping their game in terms of professionalism, not just on the game itself, but on investor relations and financial analysis. And this is a real important industry, and one that I think has earned its right over, you know, the NBA is celebrating its 75th anniversary. The NHL is over 100 years old. And so, you know, it's the greatest undiscovered business story, I think, out there.
So in terms of team ownership, obviously there are quite a number of teams on the market right now. You have the Suns and the Senators, you have the Angels, the Nationals, maybe the Orioles, maybe the Commanders, still seeing how those shake out. Have you ever seen so many teams on the market at once?
No, it's not good.
Right.
When you have so many teams out there in, you know, I don't say an unmanaged way, but, you know, they something leaks.
Flooding the market a little bit.
Right. Each situation has been different. Right. In Ottawa, we own an NHL team. It's the nation's capital of Canada, and the owner passed away. And so that will be a managed process. I think that there'll be great interest in that team. We've seen in major markets, Chelsea, London.
Say,
well, the reason that sports teams I heard were of interest was the selectivity, the non-availability. I said, do you know how many football teams there are in like a 50-mile radius of London? That didn't seem to hamper the sale or the interest. And I would say that was special circumstances, because it seemed like the country, Boris Johnson, who then was out,
right,
basically helped to architect that sale. Part of my discussion inside was the secret powers of central places of government. Ottawa is the capital of Canada. We're in Washington, D.C. We take our responsibility and also respect for policymakers. And I talked about how policy dramatically affects our industry. You kind of underreported that, I would say. Well, that's what happened in Chelsea. There was something dramatic that happened where politicians got involved and a new market was set, right? John Henry, I understand, I haven't seen officially, he must look and go, wow, I paid $400 million for the team. Chelsea is just sold for $4-5 billion, the pounds, or whatever the end price was. Yeah, I'm a trader. I understand, trader, not trader. let me see what the market will bear there. And I think that's what is going to happen around markets. Now, I don't think buying and selling teams for financial reasons makes a lot of sense. Like, I would have no interest in buying a team not in our market. Mm-hmm. If I can't go to the game, I went to London, I went and visited a couple of teams. I said, I can't do this. It's very inauthentic to me and my family as people. And I mean, I felt guilty I couldn't go to the Caps-Pens game yesterday because in New York and the traffic, and I couldn't get here. I couldn't imagine like not being able to go to the games and being with fans and being a part of something. I think the leagues have to be very, very important and bespoke about who gets to buy these teams, because they really are public trusts. I mean, they really are local in nature. They were part of something much bigger, but the, you know, the Washington Capitals, the Washington Wizards, the Washington Mystics, the care that they need locally with the fans, with the players, with the organizations is very, very demanding. And so, you know, buying and owning and leading teams diverse, if you will, geographically diverse, I think will get really, really challenging.
Well, in terms of local teams, authentic ownership, obviously the local Washington Nationals are on the market. Your name has been thrown around a lot. I don't believe you've commented on it yet. Have to ask, any interest there? What can we expect to see?
Obviously, I can't talk about it, but if it's on Twitter...
It's got to be true.
Right. I think I started a rumor. Did anything come out yet?
I haven't seen yet.
On pickleball. Why don't you ask me about pickleball?
Well, that's where I'm going. So, right. But I had to ask about the Nationals. No comment so far?
I can't comment.
All right. So looking ahead to the future, you know, I don't know if you'll remember this. We spoke about 8, 10 years ago. You told me then one day we're going to be having sports books and arenas. We're going to be sitting in our seats betting on games. And if I'm honest, I did not believe you for a second. I sat there and thought, nah, no way. Here we are now. I was wrong. You were right. Need to ask, 8, 10 years from now, the live fan experience in the arena, how is that going to be different? What are we going to be doing then that we're not doing now? Maybe not even thinking about now.
You know, I'm still bullish on augmented reality and virtual reality. It's just bandwidth. And what I believe, if you're going to be fan-based, and we're seeing a little of it on advertising. I had to watch the game from home last night. I don't watch very many home games on television. So it was, even that was a learning experience in that the ads that are coming are different here than people who are watching on their RSN in Pittsburgh. And when we go and play in Pittsburgh, the ads that will be on it now are much more organic and personalized to our audience, which makes a ton of sense, and we've used that technology. So, you know, I've always felt that we're going to have one day an experience where I want front row seats or my seats that I've grown accustomed to. People all the time say, hey, I've been a season ticket holder since 1977. Those are my seats. I own those seats for, you know, 45 years. Why can't they see the game we play in Dallas from there? Why can't they be sitting next to the people they've grown up with since 1977? And so we'll need to use technology to make that experience, that viewing, that viewpoint, who they're with. And I think that there's a magic that happens when you go to a game. I mentioned, you know, a lot of the big movie theater chains are in deep trouble right now. Some have filed for Chapter 11. And it's ironic to me because when you go to a movie theater, don't talk, which I think is right, except you come to a football game, a basketball game, a hockey team, you're screaming, you're like high-fiving, you're part of community. Right. Can you ever have community just like sitting like this? So they're gonna have to do something that says some magic is happening convening. All I ever hear on movies is from like directors. Oh, there's a magic in the big screen. Well, obviously, that's being proved not correct. It's like, yeah, my screen's 60 inches, 70 inches, it's good enough. So I try to anticipate what I see young people doing, what I know about technology and how it's being developed, and what will be a best way to go and do this. I don't gamble, I don't, it's not something I do, although I make stupid venture capital bets. I'd say that's worse than gambling, you know, on a sport book where you're so informed with the information. Right. We do due diligence. A sports bettor gets unbelievable reams of information crunched by AI, the smartest minds in the world now, just like Wall Street, only we have annual meetings every game. Right, we don't convene like once a year. We bring in our shareholders. I joke and say like every game is an annual meeting. Ooh, you get blown out in a game. And so, you know, I just try to take a business norm, technology, young consumers, and shake it up, and then how do we apply it into the industry that we're in now, which is, I think, the most important industry out there. Right. I mean, I really think that the sports business is incredibly vital to consumers. You look at a big city, universities, iconic real estate, green space, a defining business community, Hollywood, Wall Street, here, federal government, and sports teams are what make up what that city stands for. That's it. Mm-hmm. And that we have durability, that we touch so many people. They were showing inside some nice things about when we won the Stanley Cup. We're in DC. It's a really important, very wealthy community. It was pretty divided here at one point. It still is. The only thing this entire community agreed on was everyone was wearing red out on the National Mall celebrating that we had won a Stanley Cup. We were the only uniter of a very, very diverse, very differing in opinions. And someone said to me, well, no, we vote 90% Republican. I said, well, a friend of mine's congressman. I supported him. He's doing a great job. He's my congressman in my community, Maryland. He lost yesterday. Go, I wouldn't be so cocky about I know what consumers are thinking. It's like David Trone lost. Shocking. He's a great guy. He was doing a great job. But the only thing that unites people is sports. And so we're punching below our weight in our importance as a business. And I also think ownership, we're not supposed to use the word owners, governors, need to be socially conscious, because what we do, what our players do, what our organizations stand for, really goes deep into the zeitgeist of the community. And so, you know, you picked a good career place to be. We are punching below our weight for business, but I do think that the valuations are strong. And you should be, as I said, elevating to be where the main source of covering one of the most important businesses ever. And you should be able to recruit people, get investors, build news desks, places. I mean, this is your time as well as all of the people within our industry.
Well, I think I can speak for SBJ and the rest of the industry when I say, you know, couldn't be more bullish and more excited to see this Great. Industry grow and keep track of everything you guys are up to here in DC.
Thank you.
So thank you again for the time. Okay. Really appreciate it, Ted.